I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven.
Welcome to the Building Faith Families podcast with Steve Demme. I'm your host, Scott Moore. Thanks for joining us today. Good morning, Steve. How are you today?
I am well. How are you?
Good. It was fun to catch up this past weekend.
Yeah, and I don't know if you know, but there were people there looking for you.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah. And the next day they said, hey, is Scott going to be here? And I said, yeah, he was just sitting right. He was standing right where you're standing right now last night. And they said, oh, sorry, we missed him. So you have a following out there you didn't even realize.
Wow.
They were asking me about how Henry was doing, which was nice. And there was someone there that you met when we were talking, right? That you knew from another event that you were at.
Yeah, one of the guys standing in line, he recognized my voice when I said something to him. And I mentioned that I do the podcast with you. And he was like, do you do Todd Wilson's podcast too? And like, yeah. And he's like, yeah, I think we met at the Family Man rally 5 years ago. Wow. All right.
Nice.
Yeah, it was very fun. It was great to connect.
How is Henry doing today?
Doing really well. He's finally gaining weight quickly. So he gained like 100 grams the other night and gained another 50 grams yesterday. And so he's packing on the weight, which is an awesome thing.
Absolutely.
They're still fussing about the whole PDA thing, but I think it's going to be up to Abby and William to decide what to do pretty soon. But I think, you know, they're getting more information and getting more peaceful about the options. So it looks like he's in pretty good shape at the moment. We'll see how it goes.
Yeah.
Thank you all for praying. It's been, that blesses my socks off to know how many people are praying. And
yeah. Well, may God bless that little guy.
Yeah.
Someday he'll be wishing it was just grams.
No kidding.
He'll say, man, I need to go on a diet. And everybody will say, no, keep adding those grams.
Yes. Yeah.
We've got to hold those thoughts in our head.
Yep.
But it was lovely being in Cincinnati this weekend. I'm still processing. I have notes I need to journal about because I forget so much. And yet when I'm there, I'm really there and I connect with people and I hear stories and I try to remember them by going back to my room and scratching down notes, but I haven't rewritten my notes yet to go through it. But I remember one man, the first night he looked at me and he said, I heard you speak a year ago. He said, you remember when you had to run out and get to the airport right away? And I said, yeah, I remember that talk because the Uber was going to take so long. So I was begging someone in the workshop to take me. And so somebody took me to the airport. So I made my flight. But he says, you talked about abiding in his love. And I've been thinking about that ever since.
Wow.
And I thought, wow. Yeah, exactly. That really goes deep. So
that'll make you careful of what you say.
Yeah. Okay. Well, let's talk some more, but let's pray first. Father, thank you for connecting us face to face in Cincinnati. And thank you for all the different ones that we were able to meet with. We're all about the body of Christ. And more I'm realizing the body of Christ takes different shapes than just a church. And so thank you for that wonderful gathering that we had for the last weekend. Thank you for the progress in Henry's case. And bless us now as we seek you together this morning. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Yeah, I was, I don't know if you know, but let me just explain three of the talks that I gave at the conference. And then one of the things that we did was when we met together for worship. But as I was preparing for Saturday morning, 7:30, conference starts at 8:30. So at 7:30, we had the big ballroom upstairs. And I was there before 7, setting up and putting chairs in a circle and praying and different things. And one young man named Caleb, he came up to help me and he passed out the handouts when people were going in. But as I was preparing for that in my heart, I felt like God at some point said, this is fellowship. This is true fellowship. And when I go to these homeschool events, I know this is going to sound a little sacrilegious, but to me, this is my church. These are people that are kindred spirits, that love God, that are earnest about their family, that are being intentional about teaching their children and their own walk with God. And they're careful about what they watch and what they join. And we have so much in common that when we really start spending some time with each other, we found out we even have more in common than we think. So anyway, this to me is more than a homeschool event or an education experience. This to me is true koinonia, true fellowship. And so the first talk that I did the very first night was Communication UC. And what we did was, instead of just me jabbering for 60 minutes, what we did was I said, you know, I'm going to just talk for maybe a third of the time. And I'm going to outline some principles, and I'm going to give my testimony and my story of where I learned these principles. And then what we're going to do is we're going to break up into groups of three. And I tell them this right away so that the introverts can have 15 or 20 minutes to get their mind around it. And I said, look, it'll be okay. I'll give you some ideas what to say. You can let the extroverts go first in your group, and everybody's laughing. But I do know this much, not that I am an introvert, but I'm married to one, and I have a couple in my family that they need preparation. They need time to plan. They start running through their mind what they're going to have to say stuff. So
it's actually really comforting.
Yeah. So we got together, and that's what we did. And we broke up. And if there's any children there, the children come up to the front with me, and they're part of my group, because I want the parents to experience this first and without having the children there. And I try to break up spouses. I said, you know, guys, go over here. There's some other guys and girls. And so we have groups of three. And then I start off by saying, you've got 6 minutes to tell your story. But one of the caveats is, try not to say anything about your spouse, your family, where you live, or what your work, job, ministry is. Just talk about you. And if you need something specific to talk about, perhaps share an experience that has had a significant impact on your life, one or two, whatever. And you've got 6 minutes. And so the person starts off by saying, hi, my name's Steve. And everybody says, hi, Steve. You know, yeah. So now we're in AA mode,
right?
Which it really does do something to just to introduce yourself and have everybody else respond, because they've heard you, they see you. I don't know. There's something powerful about it. So, and then they share their story, 6 minutes. And then I holler from, you know, with the microphone. I said, you've got now 2 minutes to ask questions. So the other two people asked the first person to talk questions. What did you mean by this when you said this, et cetera? And then the next person's. And after 18 minutes plus the questions, 24 minutes, so it takes about half an hour, everybody's had a chance to talk. And amazingly, just that little bit of time, they connect. And as one person said, when we got back together to debrief, they said, boy, we went deep because we didn't have the normal superficial stuff to talk about, because generally we talk about our spouse, our kids, where we live, what we do, all that. So it was just powerful. And that was hard for me to get them back together, because everybody was so connecting with each other. Because once you get to these conferences, you find out that you really are kindred spirits with these folks. And there were people there from all over the country. Different states were represented, and they get together and they start talking, and there's a heart connection, and it's just beautiful to watch. And then the family worship talk, which is Saturday morning, same thing. I said, I'm only going to talk for a portion, and then we're going to break up into families of six or seven. And I had a one-page script. It was just John chapter 10, broken up into three verse segments. And I said, somebody's going to be the head of the household. Somebody is going to be the child. I gave them some colored pencils. I gave them some note cards. I said, somebody's going to write a picture of this and draw this. You're going to play a game. So we scripted it. And the same thing happened. When I left, one of the men followed me out and he said, "You see what's going on back there? One of the women in our group needed some help and some prayer, and the other ladies are ministering to her." And I thought, wow, this is wonderful. So I just really like this idea of connection as opposed to just communication, just hearing somebody jabber, but actually getting to connect with the other people and apply these principles. And then Saturday morning, we met for worship, and that was wonderful. So, yeah, it was an awesome conference, every part of it. And one of the workshops that I didn't get to do, the last conference that I got to do, this one was called A Do-Over. And unfortunately, the incorrect title was put in the program. So we get together in the room, and it was pretty full room. In fact, it was probably the most attended workshop I did. I said, "I hate to tell you, but you're here for the wrong workshop." I said, "So here's what I'm planning on doing, and the handouts that I've passed out reflect that. So if this is of interest to you, you can stay if you want to go out. I totally understand. Catch another workshop. But this is what I'm going to talk about." And, you know, that workshop went really deep. We went right off the script pretty fast. And I felt led to stop pretty early. And I said, "Ask me questions." And boy, this is where it even got deeper. And at one point, things were wrapping up and I was collecting my stuff and I was walking out, and I could tell people who were really tracking. And this one poor lady, I could see she was struggling. I just looked at her. I said, "Are you doing okay?" And then she started to cry. And then there were some other ladies around her. And I said, "Look, I don't know what to do here. Can you help her?" And so they did. They said, "Yeah, we'll take care of this." And so they made a circle and they started talking and praying. And this to me is just so heart satisfying to see people connecting with God and with each other. So there it is in a nutshell. What do you think?
Sounds like you did a good job of being sensitive to the Spirit.
Well,
I don't know how else you do that. If you're not tuned in, you'll just, flub it, which is what I'd be afraid of doing. But
well, thanks. That was a good observation. In fact, that particular talk, because I have only given it once, I wanted to get up a little early and work on it. So I walked up the two flights of steps, escalators. And when I was getting off, there was a couple sitting there. These are like the volunteer police, if you know what I mean. They're there to help run the conference, but also to make sure that everybody there is supposed to be there, has name tags and stuff. So we don't have people coming in from the outside. Usually though, just one person. And when I saw this couple, I just made a comment. I said, "Hey, nice that you got backup." I said, "Are you guys almost done with your shift?" And she says, "Well, we're here till 12, but my husband said I could go get a workshop at 11:30 I really want to go to, and he'll take the last half hour by himself." I said, "Oh, that's nice of him." And then she says, "Are you a speaker?" And I said, "I am." So she opened up the thing, and I told her what I was going to be doing, and she ended up coming to my workshop instead of the one she wanted to. And she had a real breakthrough there. In fact, I spent a good bit of time with she and her husband at the booth afterwards. So anyway, I talked to them. Then I went over and I found this little couch over in the corner where there were some families. And I thought, I'll read through my notes. And this one lady had the notes from family worship sitting in her back of her stroller. So I just said, "Hey, did you go this morning?" I said, "How'd you like it?" She goes, "Well, actually, I couldn't go because my baby and the stroller was making noise. So I was only there for the very first part. And then I left." I said, "Do you want an abbreviated version?" She said, "Sure." So she sat down next to me. I pulled out the handout and I went through all the points. And then I went in and did the workshop. So it was just like God was just arranging things for me. And it was very precious. And yeah.
Awesome how he shows up when... when you have those events. I still have notes in my phone from one of the events I went to, one of the homeschool conferences I went to, gosh, probably 7 or 8 years ago now, that, that was just really impactful. Some of the talks that I went to and people I met with,
Well, surprisingly, the last talk I did, and it's from 4 to 5 and the conference stops at 5:30 on Saturday night. Mm-hmm. So I go into the room and it's a math talk, like an overview. And there was only, I'm going to say 15, 20 people there. And it was just a couple families, couple singles. And I thought, well, this is such a small group. I might not even use my whiteboard. I might just have them come up here, sit around the desk, and we can just Well, the next thing you know, people started filing in, you know, just like church. Yeah. And we had a pretty good room, and this one lady and her daughter sitting up right in the front. And I started to pass out the handouts, and she says, well, I'm not sure I'm going to stay. And I says, you know, what are you here for? She goes, I'm just too tired to move from the last workshop. You know, after 2.5 days, listen to the workshop, these people are tired.
Yeah.
And I said, well, stay as long as you want. And here's the handout. They ended up staying the whole time. And when she was leaving, she goes, that was the best workshop I was at all weekend.
Wow. That's cool.
Yeah, that's what I thought, too. I thought, who knows? But God is definitely the one that's directing people's paths and putting people in touch with different ones and connections. And I take what my little sphere there, and I looked around the whole big convention with all these vendors and all these people, and I thought, this is happening all over. There's connections being made, and people are ministering to each other, and you just can't do that on a Zoom call.
Yeah.
You know, an online talk is better than no talk, but it's really nice to get together with God's people and rub shoulders with them and share meals with them. And yeah, I was walking across the street one night, and you know, there's this guy, S.D. Smith, with the bunny rabbits, the Ember series.
Oh yeah.
Yeah. Apparently he's like a rock star and these kids all like him. So there's always people walking around the conference that have these bunny ears. And then Great Wolf Lodge is there, and they're giving out wolf ears. So I was making jokes to the kid with the wolf ears about eating the bunnies. But anyway, so I'm walking across the thing, and they give me their big bunny ears. They says, we got plenty of them, because my son John kept FaceTiming me while I was there. So I was still on the phone with them, and they said, here, give them the bunny ears. But the next thing you know, we're talking as we walk back to the hotel. Then I saw them again the next day, and we ended up having a long conversation out on the sidewalk. And yeah, her name is Lindsay. And anyway,
very cool.
It was, you know, these divine appointments were just all over the place. Yeah. So yeah, really special. And of course, my favorite part of coming to Cincy, you know what one of my favorite parts is?
You told me, and now I can't remember.
Yeah, yeah. Well, usually, you know, Cincinnati Airport's in Kentucky, so you have to, it's like, I don't know how many miles, 10, 11 miles, and you have to get an Uber or something to get to the airport. And I thought one time, that's just too expensive. So I went down to information. I says, come on, give me some alternatives. What's my option? She says, oh, you can take the bus. I said, okay, where do I get it? It's right by baggage. And now I do it every time. I just walk out, go down to the right. Cost me $1.50. And I get to sit with people on the bus and visit. And then it drops you off right at the corner by the convention and the hotel. $1.50. So this time I tried to do something extra. So Sunday morning I got up and I was out there before 5. And 5:08, bus picked me up. It was actually 5:10. I was getting a little nervous because I was cutting a little close. But I took the bus back to the airport this time, and it was $1.50. So I learned how to use your metro transportation in Cincinnati. But I feel like I saved like $50 by just taking the bus. So
just call me if you need a ride next time.
Well, it's amazing how much joy I get out of doing this.
Yeah.
Saving money. So...
one of your nifty little idiosyncrasies.
Yeah, absolutely. And I ate from a food truck.
Just to me, the idea of riding the bus from the airport, I'd do anything to avoid that, man.
Oh, no, it's fun. In fact, when I was coming in, I sat next to a girl who was from Hawaii. She's in the military, and she was going to a wedding. And I know all about it. She's in the Army. Her husband's in the Air Force, because we visited all the way in. And then the people across the aisle from me, they were vendors. They came from Missouri and Texas, and they were coming in for the conference, and they recognized me. And she looks at me and she goes, you some kind of celebrity? So yep. Anyway, it was fun.
Awesome.
Well, let me give you a little scripture today instead of just talking about the conference. I just want to give a little testimony that I'm still meeting with God twice a day, and I even carved out time into conference. I got there Thursday, and I opened up my laptop, and in my hotel room, I was singing and reading scriptures, and I was praying. And some time ago, I'm going to say a year, maybe, I can look in my journal, but God put it on my heart that I need to be binding the strong man. And there's a couple times it's mentioned in the Bible, but Matthew 16, 19 says, I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. And whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. And whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. So I've been putting together studies, as you know, and I have 13 of them that I read through. And this morning I read through number 2. Started over again yesterday, read through number 1, and was reading these passages about binding the strong man. And then what came to my mind is, because in my Bible reading, I'm in Joshua. And you know what I'm going for, but in Joshua chapter 2, it says, Behold, when we come into the land, you shall tie this scarlet cord in the window through which you let us down. Mm-hmm. And you shall gather into your house your father and mother, your brothers, and all your father's household. Who's that? Who am I reading about?
The prostitute that helped them spy out the
Rahab.
Land. Yeah.
Yeah. Rahab. And what I noticed as I was reading this
year. By the way, can I just interject? I wouldn't know that if I hadn't just listened to that the other day. I don't know. I'd be like, so I'm not as good as you are with all this. I just sound really smart because I happened to be listening to that the other day.
Well, I remember reading one of these Bible story books to our kids when they were really young. The kind you get in the dentist office, they're like blue and they're Mylar cover or whatever. And there's like 7 volumes. And I remember reading and they talked about this being a red cord. And I said, that cord wasn't red. That was just a piece of rope. But I got out my Bible and opened it up. And sure enough, it's a scarlet cord. So I was thinking about that. And I was thinking, you know, I have to bind the strong man with something. You just don't bind him. If I say go bind somebody, you're going to go get a piece of rope or something and you're going to wrap it around them, right? Mm-hmm. So I thought, and again, I keep saying I thought, these thoughts came to me. It's like the Spirit was leading me. So I followed up on it and I thought, I looked up the word scarlet, just did a concordance study. And the first time I found it was Zera. Zerah, and it's in Genesis 38, and you probably know this. When woman was in labor, one put out a hand, and the midwife took and tied a scarlet thread on his hand, saying, this one came out first. And so then he went back in, and then he came out again, and they knew which one was first, which is very important for the firstborn. And it was Zerah, Zerah, scarlet thread on his hand. Isn't that fascinating? Scarlet thread. And then I continued to dig a little bit, and I found in Luke 14:49, this is for leprosy chapter. Here's a nugget right in the leprosy chapter, which I have to confess, I'm not always looking forward to reading every year. But the cleansing of the house, he shall take 2 small birds with cedar wood and scarlet yarn and hyssop. And I read hyssop, and I think of Psalm 51, cleanse me, David said, and scarlet. And then Isaiah 1:18, come now, let us reason together, says Jehovah. Though your sins are like scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they are red like crimson, they shall become like wool. And 2 more places, they stripped him and put a scarlet robe on him, speaking of Jesus. And then Hebrews 9:19, when every commandment of the law had been declared by Moses to all the people, he took the blood of calves and goats with water and scarlet wool and hyssop and sprinkled both the book itself and all the people. So I began praying a week or so ago that God would bind the devil in the scarlet cords. And I'm thinking about the blood of Jesus. These cords soaked in the blood of Jesus, because scripture says that we overcome him by the blood of the Lamb. This is in Revelation. So I thought, okay, I'm going to pray. Now that is a whole new thought. I don't think I've ever heard that before, but it just brings together Christ. It's not me binding him. It's what Jesus did on the cross, and I'm applying it, and I'm binding the devil in the blood-soaked scarlet cords of faith. And it just, it's added something to my prayers since I've been doing that. And I've been digging a little bit. And how much time we have? We're probably over, but let me just share a little bit more of this, because this to me was fascinating.
Yeah.
As I started digging in the Hebrew, and I found out that there's another word that's used for crimson, and it is based on a worm. And I thought, what does a worm have to do with red? And then I find out that there's this crimson worm. It's called a shield louse. And this shield louse, it ties itself to a tree. And it lives for 3 days before it dies and gives all of its color to its children. But that's the source of this red color, this crimson. And do you remember, now, I don't know if you read this or not, but you know what I'm talking about. Psalm 22:6, it says, I am a worm and no man. Jesus, speaking of that. So anyway, this word, tola, is the Hebrew word. It's used 43 times in the Old Testament. It's usually used as a color, but sometimes it's also used as a worm. And I think there's a connection between Jesus, who was tied to a tree and he was there for 3 days, et cetera. Isn't that awesome?
Wow. Yeah.
Yeah. So I'm still working on it. Yeah. Maybe we'll talk about it more when I've done a little bit more homework, but this is the idea. And here's what Charles Spurgeon says, and we'll just close with this. There is a little red worm which seems to be nothing but blood when it is crushed. It seems all gone except a blood stain. And the Savior, in the deep humiliation of a spirit, compares himself to that little red worm. How true it is that he made himself of no reputation for our sakes. He emptied himself of all his glory. And if there is any glory natural to manhood, he emptied himself even of that. Not only the glories of his Godhead, but also the honors of his manhood, he laid aside that he might be seen, that though he was rich, yet for our sakes, he became poor. And he not only, by the way, this worm attaches itself to a tree and it won't come off. And Jesus attached himself hanging on a tree. Man, I'm starting to tear up just telling you this, but this is what Jesus does for us. He becomes red. So it's in that red, crimson power of God in Jesus that we bind the strong man. And I've been doing this now for several, whatever it is, a year, months, but pretty much every day I seek to bind the strong man. But now I'm binding him in the blood-soaked cords of Christ's sacrifice. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Father, for attaching your son to the tree. And thank you for Jesus attaching himself and choosing to be attached to that tree. And thank you that that blood, that he stained that tree, and now it makes us white. Though our sins are that color, now they're white as snow. Though they're red like crimson, they're just like wool now. Thank you that we are white today. Thank you for the power of the blood, not only to cleanse us, but to bind the strong man. And in Jesus' name, thank you for this wonderful event that we shared in Cincinnati. Thank you for kindred spirits. Thank you for the fellowship of the Spirit. True koinonia, we worship you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. And that's our show for this week, folks. Thanks for joining us for the Building Faith Families podcast with Steve Demme. If you have a question for the show, email steve@spdemme@gmail.com. If you have a question for me, you can reach me at scott@unsocializedmedia.com. Thanks for joining us. Have a great week.